Quickly going to pull out some of the elements. This story structure follows the process as you'll see in a second. Let's go over basic story architecture first. So when you first start writing a filmmaking, you have a linear perspective in that sense. Pretty soon you realize that both the beginning and the ending are the same, which is why we demonstrate story structure via a loop. We identify the classic beginning and ending in a state of perfection, which is lost, becomes a state of imperfection, the lost phase, the limitations phase, and the process of returning to it is undergone. You can start there or somewhere in between. If you do that, the events there tend to be referenced at later stages, as in this story. Most stories, such as this one, end with some form of state of perfection. If you don't want to do that, if you want to end with imperfection or some combination, that's almost irrelevant. The process is always the same. So you're always going to have transformation, change, metamorphosis, transmogrification, the various arcs, psychological journey. You're always going to have physical journey, and you're always moving through new worlds, which really are physical manifestations of new psychological states and new versions of the self. Working your way around the cycle involves jumping through lots of hoops. Each hoop has its own set of sub-stages, which in essence are functions which may be performed, messages which may be communicated, they tell you what tangibles or intangibles you're going in there to acquire, how to construct those sequences. So for example, if that's the ordinary world, we know it's a state of protection, repression, fear of exit, etc. So those sub-stages show you how to construct those sequences. When you're here, you're not able to return, so you have to go forward, grow, learn, mature, let go of your older limitations, your points of view, etc. Versions of your older self, in essence, come all the way around until you're ready to return. So that's basic story architecture. It's the fundamental framework that all successful stories are based around, and I go over that in great detail in the 2100-stage of journey transformation, moving through new worlds and states, which you can purchase off the website and some of the other products on the website. So let's get rid of that. Let's draw another loop so we know now there's much more behind that than a simple circle would suggest. So Sicario. Now at the end of this movie we have Alejandro who tells Kate that she is not a wolf and that this is the land of wolves now. And that references one of the underlying ideas behind the story, and that is when wolves are causing chaos, the way to create order is to set other wolves upon them. In other words, to fight fire with fire. And a parallel idea is that you can't do it by the book to take out lawbreakers. You have to lawbreak. Not do it by the book, in other words. Another form of fighting fire by fire. So the state of perfection is lost. We are in the imperfect phase, the lost phase. That's happened in a number of ways. So we are in a world of rule and law and due process, which is the mainland of the United States. And these wolves from this opposite world, the lawless world of the Mexican cartel, they've come into our law-abiding world and created havoc. So order has been lost, which is the classic function of the loss of the state of perfection. And from Alejandro's personal point of view, he was actually an innocent, but he's become who he is now as a result of his family being massacred. So we kick off, we come into it, we meet Kate, who is this representation of law and order, believes in due process, doing things by the book. And she's leading a SWAT team into, in essence, what is our ordinary world. We've got our home, which is a classic symbol there, and it's chaos. So we find the dead bodies, the SWAT team are blown up, etc. We've got Kate, who's an innocent archetype, and we've got Reggie, who is an ordinary world attachment, kind of represents who she is at the moment. And we've got other things going on. For example, we've got transformation symbolism, so representing washing away the older self. And then we meet Reggie and Kate, and they're sitting outside the interview room or the meeting room, and we've got Jennings with Matt, and we meet Matt, and he, in essence, is our supernatural aid, and he's on Kate's side, but he believes in an opposite thing, so he believes in using, fighting fire with fire, setting the wolves on the wolves, and he doesn't believe in doing it by the book. So he's going to encourage her onto a journey in which she's going to come around and appreciate that point of view. She has to volunteer to go, so we've got a refusal, she overcomes that refusal. We've got her going to the airport to catch the flight. She leaves behind Reggie and Essence, our all new old attachment, and in essence we enter our first threshold. So in meeting various archetypes that represent a benchmark who she is and who she will become. So we meet Alejandro, Essence New World Archetypes, Alejandro, and arriving in El Paso, we meet these other U.S. law enforcement officers who are much more aligned with Matt and that opposite belief of fighting fire with fire, and they are wolfish and that they don't do anything by the book. And then we have our presentation. We've got Kate saying she doesn't have to follow Alejandro, and in other words, a refusal to change, but then forced to follow the path if she wants to achieve what she wants. And then we go and we get our first threshold tangible, which is taking out our prisoner, Guillermo, and it's during the firefight at the border on the way out where we have our first threshold separation. So she shoots someone and doesn't like it at all because there's no due process involved, it's not done by the book, and so on. And then we go into our baby whale sequences, which in essence are functions of the opposite choices that we have to make. And here we have quite a strong demonstration of the opposite side, opposite choice. And that is setting the wolf onto the wolf, so setting Alejandro onto Guillermo and not doing it by the book. That's also when our quest becomes apparent. We need to find the tunnel. The quest, by the way, tends to refer to what is acquired at the stage of the tangible sword, not what is acquired as you exit the new world. In other words, it tends not to refer to the boom. So here we have the quest to go to the to find the tunnel that leads us onto our, in essence, our deeper journey, a deeper new world, leads us into our physical separation, our road of trials as we go to Tucson. And what we do is we interrogate the illegals coming through to try and find out where this tunnel is. And Matt is forced to reveal what they're really doing. So they're going after the boss of the bosses, and that pushes us along one of the arcs that Kate is involved in, and that is discovering what she's there for. And one of the functions of the Road of Trials, at the end of it, what you do is you come out and you believe the other side. So Matt's forced to reveal what he's doing. We've got Kate looking at those photographs, and she's forced to admit that even though her and Reggie have been doing this for 2 years, they haven't made any headway, but Matt and Alejandro, with their opposite methodology, have made way more headway than she is able to. So she's reversed to believe in the opposite way. Coming around, we season our tangible swords, we find out where the tunnel is, we've got the money that's been discovered, money laundering, so we've got gold, which is a classic symbol of the sword, very much like the Golden Fleece. And then that leads us into the underworld, which really is usually a function of making the wrong choices, which then will lead to us learning the lesson. So Kate wants to do it by the book, and makes herself a target by going into the bank, and is attacked in essence by a wolf, the corrupt cop, which is her near-death experience, and she's saved by Alejandro, another wolf. So demonstrative of the lesson, of the value of having wolves around, and when she thanks him, she appreciates the value of that point of view and what he represents. All the way around, we've got our atonements. Our boon is Diaz is forced to know, go to talk to his boss. That's going to lead to our return. The atonement, in essence, is the choice between the two sides. So Reggie, between Reggie or Matt, and she chooses Matt, and she follows Alejandro and Matt through the tunnel, and that's what leads to a complete awakening. So she confronts Alejandro, realizes that she's Medellin, confronts Matt, and Matt tells her that what's going on, that they're fighting fire with fire, they're sending the wolves onto the wolves. And that's what's going to bring us back to our state of perfection, bring us back to a state of order. And then the final conflict, ultimately, is a demonstration of our argument, which is the wolf versus the wolf. and we take out the boss, some semblance of order is revealed. And then that final scene where we've got Kate forced to sign that piece of paper, thematically probably what they're doing is trying to make her admit to one, from the thematic point of view, admit to one side of the argument. So that's a basic breakdown of that story structure. If you want a detailed deconstruction, you can order it off the website, but once again, showing you that all these stories follow this process of journey and change and transformation, moving through new worlds and states, and I go over that in great detail on the website.